Well, everyone, thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Shelley Wilkinson, Director of Sales with Tricom. As a final solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it's our philosophy to be an active member in the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that, Tricom was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series, designed for our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Tom Erb, President of Tallann Resources. For over years, Tom specialized in talent solutions for companies in a variety of industries, sizes, and types. And for two of the largest staffing and recruiting companies in the country, he's worked with some of the most recognizable and well-respected companies in the United States. In 2010, Tom formed Tallann Resources, a consulting firm that helps organizations maximize their talent ROI through better recruitment, selection, onboarding, and retention processes. An expert, Tom's presented at the American Staffing Association, National Association of Personnel Services, and TechServe Alliance National Conferences. Tom's also the past president of both the Ohio Staffing and Search Association, as well as the Human Resources Association of Central Ohio. Tallann Resources is a consulting, training, and coaching company focusing on the staffing and recruiting industry. With over 10 years in the staffing industry, Tallann Resources has the expertise and proven track record of success needed to help their clients grow their business. In today's Industry Insider webinar, Tom will discuss how the staffing industry has become commoditized, and we'll discuss how you can get out of the commodity rat race, including how to separate yourself from the competition, how to initiate from a position of strength, and how to create true demand for your service. By the session, you'll see how your staffing firm can continue to grow with significantly higher margins and thrive in a commoditized industry. If you're during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A feature located on the right toolbar. After the presentation, there will be time for questions and an opportunity for you to give us your feedback on today's webinar by completing a short exit poll. So with that, I am going to turn the floor over to Tom.
All right. Thanks, Shelley. Thank you to Tricom Funding for asking me to speak. I believe this is the second or third time that I've spoken on one of these sessions for Tricom, so I must have done well enough to get an invitation back again. So thank you very much. So what we're going to talk about today is really about how the industry has become commoditized, and I don't think I'm telling this to anybody here that's on the call, but also how you can really separate yourself and how you can get away from it. And I'm going to give examples throughout of specific companies that have actually been able to differentiate themselves and have been extremely successful in getting out of the commodity rat race, as well as I'll talk about a few things that I've done over my career where we've been able to differentiate ourselves in a way that allows us to not play that commodity game. So let me make sure this works. It does. So how do we get here as an industry? How did we become commoditized? Well, there's really multiple reasons this has resulted. And I've been in the staffing industry now for about 20 years, and for those that have been in the staffing industry for a while, we've seen it change. And 20 years ago, the margins were, in some cases, 2 to 3 times what we're today. And so it's pretty obvious for somebody who's been in the industry for a while that it has become a commoditized industry. There are a variety of reasons for that. And the first is that buyers are just, in general, more price conscious today than they have been in the past. I think part of that is because of the recession that we went through. It was one of the worst downturns in the economy we've faced as a country. And because of that, there was a prolonged period of time where people had to really pay attention to pricing. And so price became more and more important over that time, and that has not gone away as the economy slowly improves. Another is that procurement or purchasing and human resources keep taking on a bigger and bigger role. Some of that is because of the price conscious change in industry in the among companies, but part of it also is just that as companies are trying to consolidate staffing, as they're trying to become more efficient, you're seeing that it's steering more and more towards procurement and HR. And one of the things about dealing with procurement and human resources even is many of these persons are now being trained in negotiation skills. So we're going up against people who have much more training than typically in our industry we give to our sales reps and to managers and to our recruiters. So we have a disadvantage there when we're working with procurement and human resources. And in some cases, they're actually getting incented to reduce costs. The other reason is that they're using staffing and recruiting differently. So when I started in the industry, the companies were using us on a temporary basis. They were using an order to fill in for a big project that they had, or peak season, or somebody was on vacation. It was starting to gain a little bit of steam, but it really wasn't used from a strategic standpoint. And I remember in those days really talking to companies about, you really should consider us as part of your talent strategy. What's been in the last few years, the companies have started to look at that. And if you start to see the numbers in the staffing industry coming out of the recovery, you can see that companies are using us much more as part of their overall talent strategy. But with that, they're spending more money with us. And that comes more scrutiny around those numbers. Vendor systems and master vendor programs, let's face it, those are created in part to commoditize services. And I remember back years ago, we had a national client that was before vendor management systems, and they were trying to customize their procurement program to use staffing to be able to order temporary employees. And they bring us the demo, and we went through it, and at the end of them creating a job order, they clicked add to cart. So that kind of gives you an idea of how much they were commoditizing it. They were looking at us the same as they ordered office supplies. And while vendor management systems and service or vendor programs have evolved over the years, it's still essentially the same thing. It's they're commoditizing our services. There's increased competition. There are relatively no barriers to entry in our industry. The biggest barrier to entry is being able to fund payroll. And so because of the attractiveness of our industry, it's going the labor statistics says it's going to be one of the fastest growing industries over the next 10 to 15 years. More and more people are coming into the industry, and more people are coming into the industry that do not have staffing experience. So a couple things. One, it increases the level of competition, but it also increases the competition that doesn't really know what they're doing and they don't know how to price things effectively. And I've talked to many, many companies over the past 3.5 years doing consulting where they really have no idea how to price. And they're making it up as they're going along, and they're reducing their rates to the point that they get the business, have no idea that they're even losing money until it's too late. The reason I'm going to really focus on today, because the thing that we have a lot of control over, the lack of discernible differences between staffing and recruiting firms. Since my consulting business about 3.5 years ago, I've talked with hundreds of staffing companies, whether that's through consulting, through speaking, going to conferences, and I'm always asking the same question: what makes you different than competition? And I tell you, 99% of the time, they sound exactly the same. As an industry, we just sound the same over and over again. If your prospect can't tell the difference between you and everyone else, how are they going to decide who to work with? If there are absolutely no differences between two, and the obvious, and it's what we're seeing, it comes down to price. So if you go to the store and you want to buy a widget, you've got two widgets side by side, and you look at them, they look exactly the same. There's absolutely no difference. Why would you pay 5% more for the one widget just because they say they're better on the packaging? And that's essentially what we're asking companies to do, is we look exactly the same, we sound the same, and yet looking for more money when we're trying to try to get out of the commodity game. How to get out of the commodity rat race? Well, I'm about several steps, and the first step is simple, but important. It's refuse to play. And what refuse to play is you have to make a conscious decision in your organization that you are not going to play the commodity rat race. And talk to companies. You know that that's easier said than done. In our industry, in many cases, we never come across a deal that we don't like. We find it very, very hard to walk away from deals. We find it very, very hard to, you know what, we're just not going to play in that space. We're not even going to go after some of these companies because they're so price conscious that it doesn't make sense for us to do that. But in order for you to switch from the commodity sale to the value sale, you have to change your mindset, and you have to change the mindset of your company. I worked with one of the clients that she knows she needs to increase her margins. She knows that she has to get away from the commodity sale, and yet she can never walk away from a deal. She can never turn something down, and she's always going there and is going lower and lower and lower. So she is not able to make a conscious decision to refuse to play. There are four different types of companies in this industry. And this grid shows you what those four different staffing companies are based on how they face their business and how much control do they feel they have over pricing. So if you look down at the bottom left, you'll see the powerless. And what this is these are companies that go at price. They're playing the commodity game. They're asking, what price is it going to take for me to get your business? What markup are you currently at? They're asking all those types of questions, and then they're trying to go in a little bit lower. They feel that they have very little control over it. These are the people that say, it's a client, and that's just what I have to deal with it, and I have to play the game. They have very little control over how they price things, and so they end up pricing very, very low. And so that I would label as the powerless. If you're just above them, there's out there that have high prices, margins, but they have absolutely no strategy around it. They don't even realize that they're pricing it of what the industry is on an average. And so I label these the price naive. There, and I talk to companies when I'm talking about their margins, when they get higher margins, and I'm saying, wow, those are really good margins. How did you do that? And there's, well, I don't, what do you mean? That's just how we've always priced it. I just picked a price, and that's what I'm with. Great that they're able to do that, but it also puts them in a very vulnerable position because, as we know, it just takes one or two price competitors to come in, undercut them, and pretty soon, if they haven't created a strategy and created a value proposition around why they're charging that, they're going to have to cut their rates or they're going to lose business. So eventually that catches up to them, and many times they end up falling down into the powerless. Over the right-hand side at the bottom, you've got your low-cost providers. These are companies that made a strategic decision to eat based on price. Ask people, who comes to mind, not in our industry, but outside of the industry, what company comes to mind? The same company comes up all the time, which is Walmart. Walmart has made a concerted effort and a strategic decision to compete based on low price. And they do that a few different ways. So they've changed their cost structure is the biggest thing. They go based on high volume. They go based on targeting people that are that the low price. They've created entire marketing campaigns around that. And on the backside, they've been able to buy volume and reduce their prices enough of what they're paying so that they can make margins. They've been able to make it work. In my experience in the staffing industry, there are very, very few companies out there in staffing that made a strategic decision to compete on price. There are a few. There are some that are out there and do that. But typically, they tend to fall more into the powerless than they do the low-cost providers. And then in the top right-hand corner, this is where we want to be. These are the non-participants. These are the companies that said, I'm not going to play the game. Hey, I maybe won't have the volume that I want, at least in the beginning, but I'm going to have for that with margin and good business. my price is going to be high, and I'm making a strategic decision to only sell based on value and to terminate the other lower cost business. So that's where we want to go. We won't be up in that non-participant area, and there are companies that do it very well, and you can do it well. If you're not there yet, that's what you want to shoot for. So what companies have in common? We've got Target, Dogger, and then RAF. So all very recognizable names in different industries. But what they have in common is that they are all highly profitable organizations in industries that are considered to be highly commoditized. And we'll look at each one of them real quick. So think about Apple, and I'm a big Apple fan. I have several books. I have my iPad. My wife has an iPad. I have a phone. But if you look at it, go to a Best Buy or a similar type of store, and what you'll see if you compare the prices with Apple is that they're really anywhere from a 20 to a 40% premium on their products. A similar MacBook, that's similar to a PC laptop or a Windows laptop is typically going to be several hundred dollars more, even though it has the same types of specs. But they have created perceived value that resonates with their customers that allows them to charge that premium, even though they're in a commoditized market. Target, we just talked about Walmart being a low-cost provider from a strategic standpoint. Well, Target's gone the other way. They said, you know what? That's not an answer that we're going to go after. We're going to look at more focusing on style. We're going to focus on the way that a different way as far as how the store laid out, the different types of products that we have. And because of that, they've been able to be much more profitable, and they've been able to get out of what is traditionally been a commoditized market. You see an organization like Kmart or even Sears, which now owns Walmart, they've tried to go head-to-head with Walmart, and you see how that's turned out for them, not being in business any longer. So when you talk about a commoditized industry, there's nothing more commoditized than sugar. But if you go to your grocery store, and you look in the sugar aisle, and all of the different sugars, your Domino sugar typically will charge 10 to 15, 20% more than all other sugars. And it's sugar. You can talk about refinement and certain things. At the end of the day, it is probably what you think of when you think of commodities first. Actually, Robert Half in our industry. Robert Half's done a fantastic job. They're a strategic decision not to be commoditized, not to take high volume margin business or any kind of low margin business. They stand very firm on their pricing, and they've been able to do extremely well over the years with that model. Step two is to adopt abundance mentality. What abundance mentality is, there are two different mentalities you can have. You can have scarcity mentality. When it comes to business, which means there's a finite number of companies out there that can work with us, and so we need to treat each opportunity like it's gold, and we need to do whatever it takes to get that business. And an abundance mentality means the opposite. It means there's plenty of business out there. We have so much going on. We need to be going after so many different opportunities, and our pipeline it should be so full, any one or two deals does not impact us and our ability to be successful. What I find is that most staffing companies have a scarcity mentality because they don't have enough stuff going on in their pipeline. They don't have enough opportunities and enough deals going, and they become very dependent on the few deals that they're working on, and it becomes so much more important for them to close deals. If you have a large number of deals that are in the pipeline, then any single one of those doesn't get as much significance or as much importance. So you need to shift your mindset to an abundance mentality. Your great strength or weakness is your ability to walk away. The problem from a negotiating standpoint when you're dealing with a client is that they typically have all the leverage because guilty of going in and saying, I earn your business. I'll do whatever it takes to be your business. I want you to be my client. What's it going to take to get your business? What markup are you at currently? If I can beat that markup, can we work together? These are all things we say in our industry. And so what happens is we very quickly take this knee approach that we need your business more than you need to work with us. When you can change your mindset and say, I'm willing to walk away, and you approach a deal as you can walk away from it, that evens the scales from a negotiating standpoint, and it changes the conversation, it changes the tone of the conversation. I can tell you that the best deals in my career, the best deals are the ones that I actually walked away from or threatened to walk away from. Because once you have that power, it really changes the way that you can approach the entire discussion. Step we're going to focus the most on here is building a killer value proposition. I talked about it earlier that of all the companies that I've talked to in the staffing industry, the vast majority of them really don't have a true differentiator. And if you don't have a true differentiator, you really can't build a strong value proposition that resonates with prospects and clients. So it's critical that you identify what your differentiators truly are. And if you don't have them, then you figure out, okay, how am I going to create a differentiator? What am I going to do differently that I can then create a value proposition that's going to resonate with prospects? So a value proposition is really the unique value that a business offers its customers. And there are two key words in this definition. The first one is unique. If providing a value to businesses or to customers or potential customers, but not unique, that's the same as everybody else. It basically isn't just an essential feature of a business. So if you're going out there saying we background check everybody, well, it's everybody's background checking everybody. We do skills testing. Well, just about everybody's doing skills testing out there. Yeah, that's a value, certainly, but it's not a unique value. So unique is the important part. The other part that's important to it is value. It actually has to be a perceived value by the customer. You could be doing something that's unique, but the customer does not perceive a value and a value that he's willing to spend more money on, then it doesn't help you out from the standpoint of differentiating yourself and getting out of that commodity rat race. Figure out what our value proposition is. You want to ask yourself some questions. Who am I competing with? What are strengths and weaknesses? And I worked for two staffing companies for a total of 16 years and in the Columbus, Ohio market. And I thought I knew my competition pretty well. And so we tried to sell against that. And here are the things that I've found since I've left the staffing company and started consulting is one, I didn't understand my competition really as well as I thought I did. And because I was, in some cases, was trying to sell what I thought was unique value, reality wasn't really unique. And I also, in some cases, underestimated my competition, and in other cases, I overestimated my competition. So you want to first take a look and say, okay, who am I competing with? And then you really want to get to know what their strengths and weaknesses are. And you can do that through shipping them over the phone or in person, basically through checking out their website, through talking to customers that have worked with both of you and ask them, what's the difference? What do we do better? What do they do better? And really understanding, because if you don't understand what your competition is offering and what their strengths and weaknesses are, you can't create difference. You don't know what is a differentiator. Once you figure that out, then you say, okay, what do we do different and what do we do better? Not just about what do we do different or better, but is it quantifiable? Can we put in a way that basically we're proving it? Because let's say that prospects don't believe us when we talk about ourselves. We don't believe salespeople when they're talking about their product or their service. You have to be able to quantify it. You have to be able to prove it. So if you find that what makes you different or better is that your turnover rate is significantly lower or your time to fill is faster, well, can you quantify that? How much faster? And can you actually have statistics that back that up so people are more likely to believe those than they are for you to just say, hey, listen, we're a better company than what you're dealing with right now. Well, take a look at what gives us credibility out there. Is it maybe the amount of time that we've been in the industry? Is it that we specialize in a particular niche? Is it that we have high tenure among our employees? Is it that we promote special training or they're all certified staffing professionals? What is it that gives us credibility? And we'll talk about that in a little more detail. Important to the client. A national staffing company, I was doing sales for them, and a while back before customer portals were pretty common, we had the early customer portal. And it provided a lot of different reporting functionality where people could go and get almost real-time reporting. They could customize it a little bit, and they could download it into an Excel spreadsheet or print it off or whatever, and it was 24/7. And so we thought this was great technology. We went out and we sold it like crazy as a differentiator. And what happened over the course of time was that our clients didn't care. They said, well, that's pretty cool, but it never went and accessed it. It never landed us a deal. And the reality of it was that if they wanted a report run, they'd pick up the phone and call one of us, and we'd run the report for them. So it really wasn't important to the client. It was unique, but it wasn't necessarily of value to the client. I think that's changed some as people have become more technically savvy. People do report on their own more, but at that time, it was probably a little too far ahead of its time and just didn't have value we thought it did. And lastly, how can I clearly state this value proposition in 10 to 15 seconds? And the reason I want to do that is because that's about the time you're going to get when you're calling somebody and you talk to them live on the phone, if you ever get anybody live on the phone again. The amount of time that somebody's going to listen to your voicemail before they determine whether or not they want to listen to the rest of the message or delete it. And it's typically when you're introducing yourself, you talk for 20 seconds of what you do, so it's your elevator pitch as well. That you can succinctly say what makes you different and why that's of value to that person. Let me give a quick hint. Quality. Quality is not what differentiates you. As I've said to hundreds of staffing companies, and the vast majority of them say quality is what differentiates them. It's the quality of their placements. It's the quality of their team. It's the quality of their pool. Whatever they be, everybody is saying that. Everybody. Your worst competitor, the person you think does the most damage to the industry and to your market, they're going out there and selling on quality. Quality has become an absolutely meaningless word, not just in our industry, but in other industries. Nothing to back it up. Nobody backs it up, and everybody says quality. Being said, there are times when you can use quality, but let me give you an example. Ford. Ford has really changed their perception over the past several years, and they're really focused on quality. How does that result for them? Well, they had their best quarter last year since 2000. Their gross margin increased 10% year over year. They stay your ideas initiative that engages with customers and prospective customers. As far as giving them ideas and how they can improve quality, they consistently had one of the highest satisfaction ratings in the auto industry. Their cars are consistently getting awards. The Ford Fusion was Star of the Year in a couple of publications last year. Why this is different is because they are able to quantify quality. They're able to back it up. When they say, hey, their quality, they can back it up with statistics. They back it up with awards that they've won. They back it up with all these different recognitions. So the only way that you can sell quality is if you can quantifiably back it up. How do we create that value, that killer value proposition? There's five steps to it. Identify your differentiators. The second is determine the benefit or the value to your clients. Okay? So what do they actually get out of the fact that you're different? Then you get the quantifiable value proposition. You figure out how you're going to market it. You market it like crazy, and you make sure that you commit to the message. Here's an example of some differentiators in our industry, and I'm going to go into more detail about each one of those and give you examples. Industry specialization, this is a huge one. Specializing in a particular area, a particular industry, in a particular skill set, particular niche. Is there such your service team that differentiates you from the competition? We're in a high turnover industry, so if you have a lot of tenure, if you have a lot of experience, that can be a differentiator for you. High pro clients, I'm the big name dropper in the world. I think that there's no quicker way to create credibility than to talk about the high-profile clients that you've had and how long they've been clients of yours. Awards and certifications, both for your team as well as for your company. Testimonials, you know, we talk about testimonials all the time. Everybody knows we should have testimonials, but few people actually do go out and get testimonials, and even fewer do anything with them. They have them. And unique service offerings. Do you offer something that's different from your competition that provides value to your prospects and to your clients? So let's industry specialization. What you want to do is identify your niche. And most companies don't think about this a whole lot. And I've talked to a lot of staffing companies that initially they say, I don't have a niche. You know, we're a general staffing company. We do it all. You in an order, we'll fill it. I've had companies that say, you know, our differentiator is the fact that we can fill anything. And I understand that. We'll say that you're going to be able to differentiate yourself much more if you have some sort of a specialization. And two, you do specialization most likely. You just may not even know it. I was working with a client, staff company in New York City years ago, and we sat down and started going through what her value proposition was. And we talked to her, and I said, well, what's your specialization? And she said, I don't have a specialization. I do everything. I do to interpreters, to accountants, to receptionists. And I said, well, I imagine that you probably do have some sort of specialization. She said, no, I don't. And she kind of got irritated, and I said, well, humor me for a second. I said, your client list, and let's go through and let's look at it by each of them by industry and by skill set that you've developed. And so, and what we found was that 40% of her business, so close to half of her business, was in real estate, was staffing in the real estate industry. She hadn't even thought about that. But the course of time, she had developed expertise in that area and started to get more and more clients and started to do networking in that area, but really hadn't even looked at it as a specialization. So we were able to take that and leverage that and create a marketing program for her and create a value proposition that allowed her to go out and position herself as an expert in that industry. And when you identify area specialization, then the terms you want to start using are niche, specialized, area of expertise. So, you know, we're a niche real estate staffing company. Our area of expertise is in the real estate profession in the New York City area. Our clients include this, this, and this. And so you can start to have those discussions and create value very quickly. When I was a regional sales director for one of the national staffing companies, I was building up the sales team in the market, and I had a lot of different cities that I was looking for sales reps in, so we had a lot of advertisements out, and we were actively recruiting, and so I started getting a lot of calls from recruiters. And what I found was that if a recruiter called me up and they were just kind of a generalist recruiter, maybe they focused on sales people, but in our industry, I just ignored them, and I cut them off, and I said, no thanks, I'm not interested. If they specialized in the staffing industry, I would talk to them and dialogue with them and maybe even give them a chance to present some candidates. They came to me and said, Tom, I see looking for a sales rep in the Washington, D.C. market. I specialize in salespeople in D. ABC for the staffing industry, and I just finished a search with ABC Staffing Company, and I have some good candidates. I would absolutely entertain those candidates, and I would be much more interested in having them help me. The fact of the matter is, if you have like specialists, as human beings, we tend to want specialists. We want specialists for healthcare. We want specialists for our car. We want specialists for whatever it might be. So it's better to be a specialist than it is to be a generalist. It doesn't have to be exclusive in an industry or a profession. It's just that you specialize in it. You can have four, five, six different specializations. But it's just an area of expertise that you have. Once you've identified that and you start to build your message around it, then you get involved in the industry. You join associations. You reach out to those. You go to different events that are having, trade shows, those types of things, and really push the fact that you're an expert in that area. This company, M-Force, a staffing company, really focuses on industry specialization. They're number 353 in the Inc. 5000. They had almost 1,000% growth over 3 years. And they really push that they're a niche special firm in engineering, design, drafting, and manufacturing. They claim 2 to 3 turnaround on this request just due to their network and their expertise. We have pretty turnover in our industry. You know, it's not uncommon to have our competitors at least turn over teams in places every 6 to 12 months. And so if you find that your team has high tenure, if they've been with you for a while, you want to make sure that you sell that as a differentiator, particularly when you know of specific competitors that have high turnover, go after their companies that servicing, because likely that's an issue. Certification and awards, are employees certified? Are they CSP, CTS, TSC certified? Do they have some sort of certification that you can go out and differentiate yourself? Less than 5% of the industry is certified in an industry certification. Do they have industry background in that particular niche that they're focusing on? CBS is now Staffmark, but years ago they had a call center division. They went out, and their value proposition, their differentiator was that they were that their recruits were former call center managers. And they would call and say, "Hey, I've been in your shoes. I've been on that side of the table before. I know what you need. I know what your issues are." And it was a real differentiator for them. What you can do this is to create a team overview, put it in marketing, put it in your marketing collateral. Make an electronic sell sheet that you can email to people, put it on a website, and really push the fact that that's a differentiator and why that's of value to your prospects and clients. The company that actually I'm quite familiar with. I've known the Callis team for years. They focus in industrial healthcare and also do some payrolling services. They've been about 20% a year for 20 years. They are now one of about 20-25 largest staffing companies in the U.S., and the average tenure executives is 15 years. For their staff as a whole, it's over 10 years. And every single one of their staff members are certified staffing professionals through ASA, every one of them. It's a huge selling point for them. It's a huge selling point to be able to tell a prospective client that, listen, if you start with us, you're not going to have to retrain a recruiter every 6 months. You're going to have the same person most likely for a long time. High clients. Like I said before, I am the biggest name dropper in the world. There is no quick way to get credibility and to get somebody's attention to list off some high-profile client that would resonate with that prospect. And about it, it's the same kind of concept psychologically as a celebrity sponsor or celebrity spokesperson. You know, a celebrity spokesperson, why celebrity spokespeople are so successful in advertisements are people associated with them, and they say, well, if that person's associated with that organization or service or product, then obviously they're credible, so I can trust them. It's the same thing with being able to talk about your high-profile clients, how long they've been with you, do studies around them, send people lists of them. Now, obviously, there are some clients that don't like you do that, and that's fine. But in most cases, you can share that information, especially if you have a strong, long-standing relationship with them. So I'm a big name dropper. It's one of the first things that would come out of my mouth when I was doing cold calls as a sales rep in the staffing industry. They're called Indivas, a personal staffing firm. They're number 866 on the Inc. 5000. They've experienced over 350% growth the last 3 years. They list their client portfolio on their website, and they break it out by industry. And what that is, it allows people are doing Google searches or even prospects that they refer to the website to take a look and say, you know, this is an impressive client list. And it does do a lot for credibility. It does a lot for value, for your value proposition. And it does a lot to build credibility and trust for a prospect that otherwise wouldn't believe you talking about how great you are. And certifications, there's a very, very small percentage of staffing companies that have any kind of best of award. And there, I've listed a few of these: best staffing firms to work for through Staffing Industry Analyst, best of staffing through Innovero and ASA, best of work, best employers. There's a variety of different ones, Malcolm Baldrige Quality Award, there's a variety of different awards that can apply for. And what to do, again, is create credibility, be you just talking about how great your services are. Hiredemics is a staffing company out of Atlanta, Georgia. Dan Campbell is actually the new chairman of the American Staffing Association. And a really impressive company. They've done a great job of differentiating themselves based on awards that they've been able to receive. If you go to their website, you can see their awards are everywhere. They have them prominent on the website. They have been named the number one best staffing company to work for in the United States, number one place to work in Atlanta and Reno. They were 2012 Best of Staffing Client Award winner, 2012 Best of Staffing Talent Award winner. I haven't updated this, but actually they were 2013 as well. And it's over their website and their marketing materials. And because of that, they've experienced significant growth, and they're doing a great job. Testing, we talked about this. We should have them. We know that we should be out and getting testimonials and that we really should be pushing them. One of the best ways to get credibility quick is to have your clients brag about you, not have yourself brag about you. Because when you're getting testimonials, is have the client be specific. You are trying to sell a certain differentiator. Then they reference that they talk about that's the reason why they've selected you over other providers. Keep it short. Just make it one or two sentences. I would even say if you have a client that's maybe hesitant to do it, clients are busy. Offer to do it for them. Just say, hey, tell you what, just tell me what you would say. I'll put it into something. I'll send it back to you, and if you think it's okay, you can tweet it or you can tell me it's okay. Much more likely to do that if you make it easy for them. Use client's name, title, and company whenever possible. An anonymous testimonial doesn't carry a whole lot of weight. I have people that have always, they come back to me and they say, well, Tom, I don't want people to know who my clients are because my competition could go to my website and who my clients are. Well, listen, if you have a presence in your market, have some presence, your competition knows who your clients are anyways. And I have the absolute worst prospecting would be to go to somebody's testimonials where they've written a glowing review and go and try and convert them. I want to go to the clients that don't like them as much and really don't want to go and try and prospect their testimonials. So I don't carry a whole lot of weight to that. I don't think I've ever lost a client because they saw them as a testimonial and called on them. Having 10 recommendations, that sometimes it's easier for them to do, but it also serves two purposes. Now you have a LinkedIn recommendation, and you can say, hey, can I use this as a testimonial as well in marketing materials and on my website? Several of my testimonials on my website are all LinkedIn recommendations and start out as LinkedIn recommendations. whenever we'll categorize them by industry or specialization, what we ask is put testimonials by industry into a sheet, just an electronic sell sheet with my logo on it, and I include that as part of my marketing lateral, and I'm specific to the industry that I'm targeting. So if I'm focusing on a particular industry today or this week or whatever, and I'm sending out some mailings or I've got some appointments, then I want them to be specific to that industry. And then use them absolutely everywhere. I use my testimonials in my brochures. I use them in my presentations, my proposals, on my website. I have them everywhere. I actually have photos of all of my testimonials. If you go on my website, you'll see there are actually photos of all of them. I think there's one where I have their logo instead of, maybe two where I have their logo instead of their picture. But in every case, I actually have their picture to make it more real to people looking at those testimonials. Source Pro does a fantastic job of this. If you go and check out their website, they're 821 on the Inc. 5000 list, 380% growth. They're an RPO company. They actually have video client testimonials on their website that are well done and are pretty impactful. So I encourage you to check those out as well. Unique offerings. We all are offering the same things to our clients for the most part. We're offering recruiting. We're offering, okay, we're going to go out and recruit people. We're going to interview them. We're going to screen them. We're going to do background checks. Maybe we're going to do drug screens. We're going to do skill testing. We're going to do all this stuff. Well, everybody does all that stuff. So what first-day checks. We do end-of-the-week checks. We do 30-day checks to make sure they're doing well. But what is it that really is differentiate you? Sometimes it's offering value adds that others don't. And here's some examples of that. I can't tell how many times I had clients come to me and ask for piece rate pricing with a national staffing company, and we offer it. We just said we're not going to do it. It's kind of a pain for us to do. But companies that actually can do piece rate pricing, and obviously you have to follow all of the employment laws, you know, minimum wage and overtime and all those things. But if you can figure out something like piece rate pricing, it can be a huge differentiator in project pricing. Transportation. Obviously, that's going to be more in your light industrial skill sets than it would be professional skill sets. Office coverage. I find that my clients, I have many staffing companies that offer that and even they sell it as a differentiator. They don't charge for it. They just, what happened was most likely is one client asked for it. They started doing it, then pretty soon other clients found about it, but they really don't sell it as a differentiator. And most companies don't have off-peak coverage, actual live coverage. There are different types of training that you can do. We provided training for one of the clients. We did forklift certification for them. Now, it was forklift certification that satisfied the OSHA requirements of on-site forklift certification, but what it did was it gave our client more confidence that these employees were fully trained in forklift, and we had it done through a third party. We charged it back to the client, but it was something that our competition didn't do. Consulting services. Can you provide consulting above and beyond what you're traditionally offering just from a staffing standpoint? And then RPO services, recruitment process outsourcing. There are different types of HR outsourcing services that you can provide them in addition to what you do. Now, in many cases, we're already doing it. We have expertise in it, so can offer it up to them. Company in Kansas City called NextStaff is the 2 years ago was the fastest growing HR services company in the Inc. 500, and they experienced almost 100% growth in 3 years. They are a traditional staffing company. They have more of a franchise model. But they also provide HR outsourcing services in a menu approach, and they very interesting. What they offer to their clients is a whole other level of service, and they've been able to differentiate themselves because they position themselves almost more as an HR services company than just as a staffing company. Even staffing is what drives their organization and their revenue. So I want to leave a couple minutes for questions. I just want to talk about the difference between differentiator and perceived customer value. So your differentiator is what obviously makes you different. But you think about what is the actual value to the client or the perceived value to the client, because that's the important thing. And just a few examples of that. So if your differentiator is niche industry specialization, the value to the client is that they're thinking, I'm partnering with an expert in the space with a comprehensive network of industry contacts. So they know the client feels like you are going to, they are going to have a better chance of getting the right person because of your niche specialty. And you are better, you should be better connected in that industry. You should be able to access candidates that they can't access. That's the real value to them. It's an impressive client portfolio. What they're really thinking is, I don't want to be the guinea pig. Most don't want to be your largest client. They want to know that you've already worked with other with companies, particularly in your industry. But they don't want to be the guinea pig. I had a friend of mine worked for a large, huge retail organization in their procurement department, and he did a lot of RFPs, did a lot of selection. And he told me once, Tom, we're cutting edge in everything. We like to pride ourselves on being cutting edge, except when we're selecting vendors. He said, we don't want to be the first one to select a vendor. We want that you've already been in our industry. We want to know that you're working with our competitors. And in most cases, in most industries, pay to share with them, they're working with their competitors. Now, there's certain industries, you don't want to tell Coke that you're working with Pepsi. You don't want to tell UPS that you're working with FedEx. But in most industries, they actually want to know that you're in the industry, that you have experience, and it's okay to work with their competitors as long as it's not their hated rival. Strong testimonials. The value to the client is I can see evidence that you're a good, reputable company to work with, and it makes me more confident in my decision, because many times, in most cases, these people are making decisions that can have an impact on not only their business, but on their own personal life and their job security. Sometimes these are obviously big decisions many times. These are big purchases. And so they want as much evidence as they can ahead of time that, hey, listen, this is a really good company. So how do we market our value proposition? The first, be consistent. Figure out what your value proposition is. You want to have it be the same all the time. Like your mission statement, but it's an external message. And so it needs to be the same over and over and over again. So be consistent, be unwavering. Don't do it for a couple of months and then say, maybe we'll tweak it a little bit, or, let's start some other things too. You have to be unwavering, and you have to give it time to take. It takes time for people to associate that value proposition to your company. And then market it everywhere. In different sales and marketing avenues, like your website, marketing materials, phone call and voicemail scripts, proposals, presentations, put it everywhere. Because what we're really trying to push is that this value proposition that you have is worth more money than paying for the competition, and that it separates you from the pack, and that they can make a decision based on something other than price. So, got 5 minutes left. Time is perfect. I'll turn it back over to Amanda and open it up for questions.
Yeah, I was just checking to see how if any questions are coming in. While we're waiting for any to come in, Tom, are there things that people typically will ask you that might be good conversation starters for some people to throw in some more questions?
I think, trying to have anything specific. I think that one of the things that people do ask on a regular basis is just, I think there's probably more questions around using testimonials, using real names, name dropping. And like I said earlier, I think that the the bet far outweighs the risk. Basically want to get permission from people to use testimonials and to use their name and their company. Some companies don't allow it. They have policies against it. But other than that, I think that that's, to me, one of the best ways to build credibility quickly. Is Amanda looking for questions?
Oh, Tom, sorry. We had a technical glitch here on our side. WebEx just booted us off the call. Sorry about that.
Okay.
Well. They just decided we were done. So we're back. Sorry about that, everyone. So you're talking about testimonials and how important it is to use testimonials, use real names, and that's where we lost you. So if you wouldn't mind reading your point, sorry.
Oh, I didn't know you lost me that way. I was just saying the probably the biggest question I get from this session is just about use of testimonials and use of name dropping, like I talk about. And you want to get permission from a testimonial standpoint. And if they're, you know, we all have certain clients where we go, we better check with them to make sure they're okay with me dropping their name. But for the part, there's no real issue with name dropping. And as far as using testimonials on weights and in marketing campaigns, I think that the value and the benefit that you get from using real names, titles, and companies far outweighs any risk that you have of your competitors reaching out to those people or finding out who you're working with.
Got it. Thank you for that.
Sure.
It looks like we have not had any questions come in. I'm sure that everybody's probably found everything that you talked about today and trying to figure out how they can implement all of your good suggestions. So we know that we enjoyed working with you and think highly of that Tallann and Resources puts out there. So I think at this point, we probably could wrap up. So with that said, I would like to thank the participants in today's webinar, especially you, Tom, for sharing your knowledge of the staffing industry and everything that Tallann Resources does. The recording of the webinar is going to be available on our website, tricom.com/resources. If you have any questions, if you'd like a copy of today's PowerPoint presentation or the recording, feel free to contact Tom or me. Thank you again for your participation, and watch for information on our next webinar session entitled Advanced Work Compensation Claims Handled, and that's on November 21st. Thank you again, Tom, so much. We really, really appreciate you doing this for us, and thanks, everyone else. Have a great afternoon.